Hello everyone, welcome to EdUtop. So today we are going to see the economic syllabus for the SEBI Grade A Phase 1 and Phase 2. So if you have seen the previous notification of SEBI Grade A, you must have seen the syllabus of the economics, okay? So today we will see that do we really need to study all the topics or do we have to study the topics in depth? How much in depth do we have to go in that topics? What are the subtopics of those topics that we have to study? That is, today we will be discussing the scope of the syllabus for the economics for SEBI Grade A. But before starting with the session, the EdUtop has brought for you SEBI Grade A Legal Officer Practice 5000 plus MCQs chapter wise, okay? And this is available for you at 30% off if you avail this by using the code EARLYBIRD, and that is available for today only. So before that, there is also free 500 plus MCQs that is being provided by the EdUtop. So now starting with the session, see the syllabus of economics for SEBI Grade A. And these are the topics that have been defined in the syllabus for economics in the previous notification. Now the first topic that comes is demand and supply. Do we have to study it in depth of all the aspects of the all the topics? Literally saying, truthfully saying, no. You do not have to study all the topics in depth. Why? Because the basic knowledge of yours is tested in the SEBI Grade A for economics. Okay, if you study the basics and if you study the meaning of all these, then also you will be easily able to answer the topics, answer the questions from these topics. And what are the subtopics that you have to study in this, I will discuss with you. So in the demand and supply, the meaning of demand and supply, the law of demand and supply, that is, you can understand in one line. Then comes the determinants of the demand and supply and the elasticity of the demand and supply. The price elasticity, the cross elasticity, the income elasticity that there is. Then comes the market structure. In the market structure, you have to just understand the characteristics of the market structure, of the markets there are. That is the perfect competition, the monopoly market, the monopolistic market, the oligopoly market and the duopoly. Then, if you understand the characteristics and the differences between these markets, then I think that will be enough for the exam. Then comes the national income, and in the national income, understanding the definition, understanding the measurement, that how the national income is measured through the expenditure method, through the income method, through the value added method. Then the concepts of the national income, GDP, GNP, NNP, NDP, what are those, and the circular economy there is, that will be enough for the national income. Then understanding the classical approach and the Keynesian approach for the output and employment. In this, you have to understand the assumptions of both the approaches. The classicals assumes the supply side economy. They believe in the supply side economy, and the Keynesians took care of the demand side economy. So you have to study the output and employment according to these two ideologies, okay? And in the Keynesian cross is the most important thing. If you understand the Keynesian approach, the consumption function, investment function will be very easy for you. Just have to understand the definition, the formula and the diagram of the consumption and investment function. That will have all the things that you need to study for the consumption and the investment function. Then comes the multiplier and the accelerator. In this also, you just have to do the definition and the formula. That will be more than enough for the multiplier and accelerator. If you understand what these are, what the terms mean, then the formula will also be very easy for you, okay? Then the demand and supply for money. What is the demand for money? What is the supply for money? As well as on which components the demand of money and the supply of money depends on. Then comes the ISLM model. See, the demand for money and the Keynesian model, demand and supply for money and the Keynesian model were very important. And here also in the ISLM model, the IS curve depends on the Keynesian model or Keynesian cross, and the LM curve depends on the demand for money and the supply of money. That is, the IS curve depends on the product and the goods market. The LM curve depends on the money market. If you understand that how they are dependent or how they are derived, what is the meaning of the two curves, how the two curves are formed, then you will easily be able to understand this and you will be able to give any answer to any question related to the ISLM model. If you understand the Keynesian model and the demand and supply of money and how the ISLM model are derived from these. Then the inflation and Phillips curve, that how the Phillips curve is related to the inflation. Okay, the short run Phillips curve, the long run Phillips curve, the natural rate of unemployment, and how from the short run Phillips curve we came to the long run Phillips curve. Then the business cycle. If you understand the different phases of business cycle, what is the recession, what is the depression, what is the boom, then you have covered the business cycle very well. The balance of payments. In the balance of payments, the components. See, balance of payment meaning the balance of trade, what is it? The components of balance of payment, that is the current account, the capital account. What are the components of the current and capital account? What is the errors of omissions? Foreign exchange market, the different kinds of rate, the flexible rate, the floating rate, the managed floating rate, the fixed exchange rate, and how the market exchange rate is determined. You have to understand that. Okay. Then comes the inflation, the types of inflation, the causes of inflation, the demand pull inflation, the supply side inflation, demand side inflation, cost push inflation. Then the monetary and fiscal policy. In this, you have to do the monetary policy, that is under the RBI, the components, or we can say the instruments of the monetary policy, that is the CRR, SLR, reserve ratio, the repo rate, and the reverse repo rate. So you have to do that, components and instruments, as well as how RBI uses those instruments to control the inflation or to boost the economy. Then comes the fiscal policy. You have to study the government budget and the components of government budget, that is the expenditure and the receipts, the capital expenditure, revenue expenditure, the revenue receipts, the capital receipts. Then comes the last topic, non-banking financial institutions. In this, you just have to understand the definition, what is the meaning of these, how they are differentiated or how they are different from the banks, and what are the different type of NBFCs or the NBFIs. Okay, so you do not have to worry if you are not from the economics background, then you will be thinking that how we will be able to even cover the basics. You do not have to worry, because we are bringing the series for the economics, and in that series we will be talking about all the important topics and the subtopics, and that will be important from the SEBI grade A. Okay, and we will be making a very crisp videos, very small videos, so that your time is not wasted and your precious time can be saved, and you can understand the important topics for the SEBI grade A. We will also bring the MCQ questions in those series, so that even you can practice by understanding the topics and by doing the questions also, as well as the strategy sessions will also be brought for the SEBI grade A economics. Okay, so thank you very much. I hope you have understood the scope of the syllabus. Do not go too much in depth, just understand the basics, and you will surely be able to give all the answers of the economics in SEBI grade A. So thank you very much. I hope you have understood, and if you have any query, you can mail us here and you can contact us through this number. Thank you.